Right, so this will be the first part of the narration of the question formula for the bending. So before we go on to this, as with torsion, we want to talk a little bit about the deformation assumption. So let's talk about so the idea here is we initially have an element we're going to call B. You know, I think you all kind of know B's basically look like what they refer to, but they fly over this, something like this. There's an x-axis, y-axis. And then when we put bending on this, and we can consider at each point lateral displacement and we'll talk about it later. That'll be akin to how we describe the deformation, like U or an angle of twist. For now, let's talk a little bit about what goes on with the assumptions that go on. So when this beam bends, well, this really isn't much of an assumption, but we consider that there's on one surface compression. That kind of makes sense. If you imagine just taking a paperback book, try to bend it up, you see compression on the top side, and then on the bottom side, you see tension. And that means somewhere in between, there has to be neither compression or tension. There's a point at which you switch from tension to compression. You label that. This is whether it's zero axial stress. Normal stress is zero. On the tension side, normal stress is greater than zero. And on the compression side, normal stress is less than zero. Right? So there's some point at which that transition. That point is going to be called the neutral axis. That makes sense. It's neutral with respect to being either tension or compression. Alright, the other assumption that we make is that any cross-section, planar cross-section with undeformed shape, when it deforms, it remains planar and also remains perpendicular to fibers along the x-axis. Make sense? So that's the second. Stay in a plane, form such that it stays in a plane, and that the planes, the form planes, remain perpendicular. Okay? Now, so we're not seeing anything that might be like this, which is actually what happens. So it's attributed to shear. Normally, what you see is perpendicular. Instead of everything staying plain, a lot of times what you see is actually like that. And you can see that if you take a thick book, bend a phone book, and you can actually see those types of patterns. The other thing that you can see that with most quarterback protections as well, is that even if it doesn't move out of the plane too much, a lot of times when it bends, even if it does stay planar, it doesn't quite stay perpendicular. If you see that, you can always see that. So you see, if I bend it like this, edges of the book don't quite stay perpendicular at the max. If you try to force it to do that, it's actually quite stiff. Very difficult to do. Right? This softness is the deformation. This is what's called shear deformation. And we'll study that in the next chapter. But for now, a basic assumption is that it doesn't exist and that the planar section remains planar and perpendicular. Now, where you see that idealization is very long, slender beams. Okay, these tend to support this idealization. As beams become thicker, they tend to, you know, like that book, you tend to see that the shear effects become dominant. Right? These two things here contribute to shear. And for slender beams, shear effects are, you know, deemed small. So what's a slender beam? Well, this is called the 2C. And this is the length. Practically, if the aspect ratio is defined as L times 2C, this is greater than 20. It's definitely a slender beam. Maybe you can get away with 10. Less than 10 becomes questionable. How good these assumptions are. And obviously, that's affected by how good of an answer you want. If you want a coarse approximation, you know, maybe even an aspect ratio of 5 is acceptable. If you want a very good calculation and you have an aspect ratio of 10, you might want to consider shear to correct your answer. We'll talk about that. So those are the assumptions we're making when we're talking about even. Ends up. Obviously, compression on one side, tension on the other side, and that means that there has to be an axis where there's neither tension nor compression. That's the neutral axis. And then we're going to assume that the planar sections remain planar and perpendicular to that neutral axis. In reality, you tend to deviate from that. That's associated with shear type of phenomenon. But when we have very long, slender beams, or those shear effects. Okay? That's our assumption. Now let's do some math and see what that means. Okay? So here I'm going to draw a uniform beam segment. So there's my initial beam segment that's supposed to be uniform. So we don't know exactly where it is yet, but we're going to hypothesize, as we discussed before, that there is going to be some position after we bend it where the strain is zero, or the stress is zero. This is the neutral axis. Okay? We don't know exactly where it is yet. We call this position 1 because it's the bottom edge. That's the location. But I don't know what that is yet. Now, when it deforms, this is going to deform as follows. This is positive bending on this section, right? Bending over like that. And there might be more beam to right and left. So it basically is going to deform as follows. This is very heavy deformation. I don't see this practically, but this is just draw a picture. This is again the deformed position of look at this. I can take these measurements, all our measurements, and they converge to some point, center of curvature. Alright, so that's the point where if I draw it, all these intersections intersect. So this is a small segment. We're going to call this basically delta x. This is a segment that we actually spin. So this thing bends up with points of configuration. Extends out in this situation. Let's define another coordinate system from the neutral axis up. That's going to be my y-axis. Alright? So y is equal to 0. I'm going to call y 0. That's the location of the neutral axis. Although, right now, we don't exactly know what it is, but we know the neutral axis exists, and so that's going to set up a description. If this is delta x, it bends to a region where you have a constant radius of curvature, or at least in the limit of delta x versus 0. So we have an included angle, we call delta theta. And now we can find the actual radius of curvature, rho. Rho is the radius of curvature. That's the radius of curvature. The radius of curvature is bigger, there's not as much bending, right? The radius of curvature gets smaller, more bending. So the radius of curvature of infinity is basically no bending, right? The smaller the radius of curvature, the more bending. We also will typically define the curvature, which is 1 over the radius of curvature. So it's the inverse of the curvature. It's the inverse of the radius. So in this case, smaller radius of curvature, this is the radius of curvature of 0. This is the curvature of 0, radius of curvature of 0. As the radius of curvature gets smaller, the curvature goes up. Okay? All right. Now, we want to look at the strain. Well, really, I want to look at the stress. So let's. Draw this over here, a little bit bigger. Y-axis, y-direction. Now, from before, right, we know we have compression on one side. Want to look at how that varies through the cross section. Well, if the planar sections remain planar, we can actually get the strain over that cross section. We can get the strain as a function of y. So if you think of the strain is going to be a change in length, the normal strain over the original. So if you look at some position, y, forms, so the change in length is this arc length over this original length. Okay? Minus this original length. Okay. So let's do that. So the original length. You can see from this picture that has to be the delta x. The original line is delta x. what's the new one? This one here. That's the L5. Alright. Well, it's going to be this distance here times delta k. This distance, this is the radius, this distance here is rho minus y. This distance. Curvature minus 1. So that means L prime is rho minus y times dk. Alright. Well, I got a d theta and dx. It's not so great. But actually, the dx and the d theta can be related. If you look at this fiber here, the neutral axis. That neutral axis fiber, this distance here, that has to have an arc length of, that's where y is 0, so that's just got an arc length of y. Okay, right? But by definition, that's the point where there is no stretching. So this has to equal the original. Y equals 0, the stretch length has to be the original. So that means that it's actually like this. The original length has y times rho equals 0, right? This length here is where y equals to 0, so you just get rho d theta, right? Here, so y equals 0. That's also the neutral axis. There's no stretching, so it has to equal its original. Rho d theta equals dx. So I can change the rho. So now what do we have? The change in length is current length over original length divided by the original. Current length, we're saying this is rho. Original length, we're saying, is rho d theta. Now you can see all the d thetas cancel out. So I have a rho minus y d theta, this, minus rho theta over rho d theta. All the d thetas cancel out. This minus rho. Now we're just left with minus y. Okay. So that means that the strain varies linearly as a function of y. So when we go up in positive y, strain becomes negative, increases, and then when we go down here, it becomes positive, tension increases as well. So the actual we would apply the strain, it would look like this. This would be the compression. This would be the tension. And the slope here is the minus y. Right on curvature. Okay? Okay. Alright, so that's our deformation pattern. Alright? It's going to vary linearly. Compression on one side, tension on the other side. Obviously, when I flip the bending moment, you know, side, which is tension, compression, flip. But there exists this neutral axis where it's neither in tension or compression, right? So those are the important things. We don't know where that neutral axis is yet. And also, we don't know how this strain relates to the internal forces, right? So remember, the other thing we're going to want to do segment, very similar to what we did in torsion, have some strain and then therefore some stress distribution on one side. And that is going to have to balance internal forces. U of X, global force of X. Okay? So we don't know the location of the neutral axis. Don't know how internal forces are related to this assumed deformation. These are kind of like two unknowns. All right? So we're talking about that. Let's recap that. Maybe you can argue that this is a pretty long-winded way of saying something pretty obvious. But, you know, we're going to make this bending assumption that the planar section is planar and perpendicular. That basically shows us that we have to have a strain distribution that varies linearly from tension on the bottom side to compression on the top side for positive bending. What's that? If there exists this neutral axis through the middle where it's neither in tension or compression, length of the fiber remains unstretched. From that, we're able to get the strain as a function of y. See, it's this linear relationship. Now, I don't know the radius of curvature. I don't know this distance here. That is the location of that neutral axis. Okay. So what we're going to do next is find the location of the neutral axis. So a little longer than I thought. Sylvia. So, yeah.